So now we're going to go into the next section here, which is building off of the codecs, which are pretty powerful inside of the camera. Now we're going to get into some of the workflows. This is very, very powerful what we're going to do here, because it's the first solution for wireless CDL. Now, for those of you that haven't had experience with CDL, so what we've got here is this is very, very common on the set today with DITs and how the set works. This is a very, very common practice. Cameras output log. People want to capture some sort of log format, right? So that's very, very common. But we don't want to monitor log. We don't want to see log. We don't want to know it exists, right? Like, we don't want anyone to get fired because something's logged. What the heck does that mean? So we go through DIT carts who typically have these little normalizers. These are called HD links. They're by the company Blackmagic. They're very popular. You've probably seen them all over the place. And they're pretty small, so you probably use one even if you haven't seen it. What happens is the log picture from the camera goes into the Blackmagic box, and the Blackmagic box is connected to a computer. That computer, in this case, we're using Palmfort, makes a software called LiveGrade. That computer then allows a DIT to connect to a color control surface, and then it feeds a colored result back into the HD link. So the HD link now has a colored version of the log picture because it's running through a computer. Cables do all this process. Then the HD link feeds that signal back out to the monitors. So if you follow the signal here, you start with a log picture that goes into a CDL grading tool. That CDL grading tool is then put into a live grading normalizer like the Blackmagic HD link, and then gamma corrected results come out. It's very popular. I use it on all my shows. In fact, one of the authors of the CDL solution, David Reisner, is here tonight, and you know, this is very, very common. So David, do you approve of this message?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Okay. So this is where I've done this a million times on set, and the problem is I just don't like cables. It's just, there's such a pain in the butt, and following the signal flow and having the requirement of these normalizers. So what we decided to do is put the HD link in the camera. And by doing that, the result of wireless CDL looks like this. The cameras are feeding their recording log. They are feeding gamma-corrected results through Palmfort LiveGrade, but they are completely capturing and storing that metadata as a separate file, which means you're not baking in anything. It just looks like you're shooting gamma-corrected, which is what you want to pretend you're doing anyway. So you have the benefits of capturing raw, but you have the advantage of seeing it gamma-corrected, and you can do that without any cables, because the metadata is saved and managed by the camera. So it's very, very cool. Here's kind of what it takes, taking it a step further. When you take a P2 file, a P2 card, and download it, you get a bunch of folders with stuff in them. And inside this little clip folder is the CDL in the LUT. This is a big breakthrough, and it's actually an incredible achievement, because when you think about this, up until this moment, CDL, color decision list information, and their independent LUTs have been separated from video recording. They are not part of the same thing. And you have a DIT creating a database, sometimes, most of the time by hand, some sort of database, and then you have a camera that's recording negative, and those databases and those negatives are completely different systems. They're different tools. They're often different languages. And you have to go to some sort of third-party group or some sort of post house or something to merge, to marry those two things together. The VariCam is receiving the CDL data from LiveGrade in this case, and it is saving it inside of the negative. And by saving it inside the negative, it's separately, we get a separate CDL and a separate LUT. I remember when people started experimenting with CDLs and LUTs, one of the first things that ambitious DPs would say is, how many LUTs can I shoot on this movie? Now, if you're the friend of an ambitious DP, you say as many as you want. If you're a post house, you say one. And this now means if you did 99 looks on a movie and went bananas, per day. 99 different LUTs and 99 different CDLs are forever attached and merged to their hero negative. For the visual effects community, this is a major game changer because it just auto-organized the entire visual effects color science pipeline. It's done. You can't accidentally give the wrong LUT with the wrong CDL with the wrong shot. But that's what everything happens without when they're separated. And this is all done wirelessly. So we're going to take this into a demonstration. We're going to bring the lights down here. I'm going to go to a black screen so that it's as dark as possible. And so I'm going to invite Andy up here. So Andy Davis, you recognize her. She's the artist that was in the reel. So let's welcome Andy here. She's not an actor. She actually is an actress. She actually happens to be a real artist. So grab a seat, Andy. And so what we've got here is we've got, we're trying to set up as best we can a little mini real world. As real world as you can get in a theater in front of 130 people. That's as real world as this gets. This is a Panavision Primo. I think it's a 19-90. And it's a two-way. So what we're going to do is set up our little setup right here. So while they are finishing setting up, I need a volunteer of someone who's a DIT in the room. Who's a DIT? Helps if you're bold. What we're going to do is, why don't you, can you make your way up here? Is that possible? What's your name?
Enrique.
All right. Let's welcome Enrique down here. So, Enrique, this is our, this is Pomfret LiveGrade. And so what you've got right here is your CDL world right here. So basically, you can click and drag and adjust your CDLs. Now, this is a computer that has no cables attached to it, otherwise known as wireless, people. This is wireless technology, okay?
Nothing up his sleeve.
That's nothing up my sleeve. So, Enrique, what I want you to do is first, I want you to go down and click on bypass color. What Enrique is going to do is he's going to bypass the color. So right now we have an independent 33 vertices cube and a separate color adjustment. So we have a LUT and color. So what Enrique just did is he turned off the LUT and the CDL color. So this is happening again. He's talking to the camera. The computer is just a terminal. Not actually doing anything, the camera's doing the work. So why don't you start your shot, guys? Roll camera. And so we're looking at this in log. So now, Enrique, let's go and go back to, what did we call it here? Our graded. And now what I want you to do, it's going to apply the LUT. So now it's feeding the 33 vertices cube. And as many cubes as you want to feed the camera, you can do that. And so it's going to enable that there. But once you've uploaded your LUT, what I want you to do, Enrique, is just start adjusting. You can drag your color wheel, and you'll start to see your adjustments there. So why don't you go a little more extreme, so you're pulling it more green. So why don't you pull it more warm or something like that. Give them something very distinct to show. So as he adjusts that, there you go. So he's seeing this, his CDL adjustments there. This iPad will allow you to use the rings. So if he's adjusting the gamma up and down, so he's made kind of a green look here, and yeah, he's adjusting that. So this is the CDL going into the camera and starting to adjust and save. And again, the CDL is saving into the negative itself, which is really, really critical. That's basically, Enrique can save his looks just like a normal CDL process, and every time he hits upload, it'll upload that CDL to the camera. Whichever CDL is in the camera, if you only upload one, every take you roll, it'll just keep duplicating that CDL and that LUT into each one. That's looking nice now. That's looking really good. So we've got our little image there. Let's give Enrique a round of applause. Thank you very much, sir. Good job. So what I'm just going to do is add a little saturation to this. So I'm going to push up the saturation and then kind of dial it in there, and maybe I'll warm it up a little bit, something like that. Maybe that's a little too much. Maybe a little bit of contaminated blacks I'll add. There we go. So there's our shot. And of course, if I went to bypass color, I'm now turning that color off. And if I go to graded, it's now turning that on. Hopefully you can see that difference. There's bypass color, and that's that off. So now we're going to go to this next section. which is in-camera dailies. This is one I'm really, really passionate about as well. This is pretty exciting stuff. So the way in-camera dailies works is pretty cool. So again, when we talked about how the camera works, we saw there's a folder. Inside that folder is these other folders, and that's how this camera actually works. A lot of cameras just put all the media in one folder. This camera breaks it up because it can do so much. And this was one of the things that Taka and I and the engineering team back in Japan figured out, and I'm really, really passionate about this. Steve Jobs is a person, and one of the things that I learned a lot from him was this idea of self-cannibalization. He believes that if you self-cannibalize, which is to say you try to put yourself out of business, it forces you to come up with ways to innovate, to create new business. And by staying in the status quo, you eliminate the part of your brain that is constantly trying to be invented and trying to be innovative. And this is something that I think is absolutely true. And I think it keeps you on your toes and keeps you developing. And one of the things that my company, about half of my company, Light Iron, half of our business is focused on set. It's on set data, on set dailies, that type of thing. But I realized that I could draw a line, and sort of the innovative part of my brain was able to determine not only if the dailies process could be evaporated completely from post-production, but when. And then, if I knew when it would happen, how could it happen? And so that's a great conversation starter for an eager engineer who's like, wow, how can we do that radical thing and make it part of the camera? And this is how it's done. The camera's going to shoot an AVC ultra file. So that's your 4K hero negative. If you're using codecs, it's going to record it on the codecs recorder. You're going to get a hero file. All right? Then the camera simultaneously can capture a ProRes 2K or 1080 file. So you can also get 2K files out of this camera. But you can also get H.264 files at the same time as well. So this is the first camera that's capturing multiple flavors concurrently, which is a very, very big deal because, you know, only a few years ago, if you were to say a videotape camera could capture, you know, 2, 3, 4 streams of video, you'd be like, oh my gosh, that is a miracle box, right? Now we realize, sure, that's technologically possible with a computer. Well, why don't cameras do that? They're just computers with, you know, lenses on them. So let's try to make that happen. But then we said, we can't just capture files that are just random files out of this stuff. Because the problem with that is the file still needs to go through some sort of post-production, right? It has to go through some sort of post-production. So the first thing that happens is all wireless control, and I'll show you the interface in a second, but all wireless control, those dailies can independently be designed wirelessly to have some sort of color correction. So you can either make them in log, or you can make them gamma corrected, your choice. The ProRes could be one way, the H.264 could be another way. It's totally your choice. Independently, those can also be set up to have a 235 mat or a 185 mat or a 2.0 mat. You can customize any mats and you can control that. One flavor may get it, another flavor does not get it. You have that control over it. You can also add watermarks and window burns. So the window burn can be the time code, the magazine number, the frame number, or the roll number, and the file itself. So you have the ability to generate those. They're migratable, so you can move them to different corners. If you have a different preference of where they belong, you can do that. You can change the size. You can change the opacity. So you have those controls as well. You can also add a custom watermark. You can change the size. You can change the opacity. This can go to the ProRes. It can go to H.264 A or B. You can control those things with or without the color correction attached. So all of a sudden, you have a solution that is routable. It's basically you're creating a little routing matrix, and this is kind of what that looks like. I don't want to get too technical here, but basically what you're looking at is a world in which you have your ability to have a main recording. This is how most cameras work. Most cameras have a single track brain, and they just record one flavor, and you can have some sort of gamma on or off, right? But then this camera allows you to add a CDL and an independent LUT, your choice. These are dot cubes, by the way. You can have your gamma go through, and you can make that part of your sub-recording. You can control here the window burn, the watermark, and the gamma and the color and the aspect ratio as well, all independent of your main recording. And then off of that, you can control that independently for the different monitors of the camera, because we understand what the web delivery system may require is not necessarily what the operator wants to look at, right? So you have to have independent control of what you're processing and what you're viewing. So we tried to think, what would a DP complain about if we made in-camera dailies? What would a post house complain about if we made in-camera dailies? And we tried to make sure nobody can complain. I know Bill Hogan will find something to complain about, but I need that so that we can actually make it better. Where's Bill? Love you, Bill. All right. So we'll be able to basically, with the help of people seriously like Bill, we'll be able to figure out exactly what the cinematographers need and what the post houses need, and we can generate super high quality dailies instantly. So when the DIT is downloading, these proxies are very small. I know someone out there is like, well, now you just gave the DIT more stuff to download. Well, these are small. These are very, very small. 2, 3, 4, 5 megabits a second. You can control the bit rates if you want. That means you can download an hour of footage in under 3 minutes. So it's not going to be a very heavily taxing situation for the data. However, it's more about the distribution. Rapid distribution, web distribution. Everybody talks about the cloud, right? How are we going to do the cloud? How are we going to do the cloud? I got news for you. You're not going to be moving ONEG over the cloud anytime soon. And I know there are a few people out there doing it, but it's like sucking a golf ball through a garden hose right now. It's not really simple. And so most people need to be able to move data quickly. And so these proxy solutions allow you to use literally a proxy, a small version of the real thing, so you can get it to wherever it needs to be, so you don't have to use the cloud for ONEG. You can ship the ONEG wherever you want, relink it later, but you can work with proxies instantly without a delay.